Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. This is what you will hear on today's program. Experts think Nigeria is a good place to generate solar energy, but projects there face delays. Jill Robbins and I tell why. John Russell has a report on which country is leading in gaining international patents for inventions. Brian Lynn reports that NASA has awarded SpaceX with the contract to build a vehicle to take the International Space Station out of orbit. Then Andrew Smith joins Jill to talk about pets on the lesson of the day. But first,
about half of Nigeria's 200 million people cannot get enough electricity from the country's electrical grid. Many poor rural communities have no electrical service at all. Nigeria has a lot of sunny weather, and solar energy appears to be a good way of producing electricity there. But Nigeria has had problems getting solar projects completed. Experts have produced studies that say Nigeria could generate more electricity than it needs from solar energy centers. But 14 large solar projects in the northern and central parts of the country have not gone forward since contracts were signed in 2016. The projects reportedly could produce 1,125 megawatts of electricity if completed.
Supporters of solar energy in Nigeria blame high interest rates, which can be as high as 15%. The International Energy Agency says that is much higher than in developed economies and China. Borrowing costs increase total costs for solar companies working in Nigeria. Other countries in Africa have also been slow to develop solar energy. Africa has one-fifth of the solar energy capacity of Germany. Just 2% of so-called clean energy investment goes to Africa. Najim Animashan is director of Nova Power, one of Nigeria's stalled solar projects. He said, if the same project is put in Nigeria and Denmark, the Danish project will get funding for a 2-3% interest rate. He said his project struggles to get loans at interest rates of 10% or higher. He said this is the case although his solar project can produce 2.5 times more power.
Nigeria does not set electricity prices that are high enough to recover the cost of generation. As a result, companies that distribute power cannot pay producers enough to cover the cost of generation. The power production industry depends on the government to supply the difference. This situation worries lenders. Current estimates say the government owes power producers $2.7 billion. This situation makes it difficult to get loans. Some have suggested that the World Bank should guarantee loans for solar projects. But Nigeria's government does not want to face possible large payments if electricity projects fail. Edu Okeke is the managing director of Azura Power, which is involved in a stalled 100-megawatt solar project in Nigeria's northern Katsina state. He said, without a World Bank guarantee, nobody will develop or finance a project with a government subsidy, because it can disappear.
The lack of electricity has real effects in places like Excellent Moral School and the city of Ibadan. The school has no electricity. Founder Muyadeen Raji said, "The entire community is not connected, including the school." Raji said, "The lack of power means students can't learn how to use computers or the internet, and can't study in the evenings." Places that are connected to the grid often experience power outages. So they use power generators that run on diesel fuel. Last year, the government removed oil subsidies. Fuel prices went up. The head of Lorat Nursery and Primary School in Ibadan, Abdul Hakim Adedoja, said the school stopped using its diesel generator because of the cost. He said the school can go for 2 weeks without power, although it is connected to the grid. Adedoja added that students cannot complete their assignments at home. Businesses are limited by the energy deficit, too. Ebunola Akinwale owns Nature's Treat Cafe in Ibadan. She said she pays $1,700 per month to operate emergency generators for her 4 stores. "If nothing changes, I probably would have to close 1 or 2 branches," she said. The government says that if Nigerians paid full price for electricity, foreign investment would come in. However, labor groups recently went on strike to protest the price increases. Business people, like Ekinwale, support the government's position. She said electricity from the grid is cheaper and cleaner than her diesel generators. But former regulatory chief Sam Amadi doubts that Nigerians can today pay for energy consumed without subsidy. He thinks the government should offer tax reductions, payment plans, and support for private solar projects. Until then, he warned, electricity outages will remain common. I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
Recent United Nations data shows that China is ahead of other countries in filing patents for generative artificial intelligence, or Gen AI, inventions. China has filed 6 times more patents than the United States. Generative AI produces text, images, computer code, and even music from existing information. Generative AI is growing quickly, with more than 50,000 patent applications filed in the past 10 years. The World Intellectual Property Organization, or WIPO, says, WIPO is a UN agency that oversees a system for countries to share recognition of patents. Around 25% of the patent applications were filed in 2023 alone, WIPO said. This is an area that is growing at increasing speed, and it's somewhere that we expect to grow even more, WIPO's Christopher Harrison told reporters recently. China filed more than 38,000 Gen AI inventions between 2014 and 2023. In comparison, the United States filed 6,276 over the same period, WIPO said. Harrison said the Chinese patent applications covered several areas, from autonomous driving, to publishing, to document management. South Korea, Japan, and India placed third, fourth, and fifth, respectively, with India growing at the fastest rate, the data showed. Among the top applicants were China's ByteDance, which owns the video application TikTok, Chinese e-commerce company Alibaba Group, and Microsoft, a backer of OpenAI, which created ChatGPT. WIPO's Harrison said while chatbots with the ability to copy human communication are already being widely used to improve customer service, Gen AI could change industries like science, publishing, transportation, or security. For example, Harrison said data suggests Gen AI-created molecules might help speed up drug development. WIPO said it expects even more patents to be filed soon. And the agency plans to release a future update of the data, possibly using generative AI. I'm John Russell.
The U.S. space agency, NASA, has chosen SpaceX to produce a vehicle to take the International Space Station, ISS, out of orbit at the end of its service life. NASA recently announced that SpaceX will design, develop, and build the spacecraft. The vehicle will aim to guide the ISS through a final re-entry into Earth's atmosphere. NASA calls the spacecraft the U.S. Deorbit vehicle. The agency said the deorbiting operation will take place sometime after the station's operational life, which has been set for 2030. NASA said its contract with SpaceX to build the deorbit vehicle was worth $843 million. This does not include costs to launch the vehicle. The agency said the launch would be part of a future contract. California-based SpaceX has an existing relationship with NASA. The company has established itself as a dependable private partner of the agency since 2020. Since then, SpaceX has made regular trips to carry astronauts and supplies to the ISS. NASA announced last year it had decided on a plan to deorbit the ISS after service ends in 2030. The agency and its international partners agreed that the orbiting laboratory would one day reach the end of its technical lifetime. The station has been continuously inhabited since November 2, 2000. In a statement, NASA said it chose the method of deorbiting with a specially designed vehicle to provide a safe and responsible deorbit of the ISS in a controlled manner. The space agency did consider other choices or options to retire the ISS. One option would have involved the use of several Russian spacecraft in a deorbiting operation. Another plan called for taking apart the space station in space and transporting its pieces back to Earth. Still another option was to move the ISS to a higher orbit where it would remain out of service. But NASA officials have said none of those options met the agency's requirements for safety and effectiveness. The agency noted that while SpaceX will develop the deorbit spacecraft, NASA will take ownership after development and operate it throughout its mission. Neither NASA nor SpaceX have provided further information about the planned deorbit vehicle. But Bill Spetch, a leader of NASA's ISS program, recently spoke to reporters about it. He said the current plan is for the deorbit vehicle to be based on the design of SpaceX's Dragon spacecraft. Versions of the Dragon spacecraft have been used to carry astronauts and supplies to the ISS. Spetch noted that while the new deorbit vehicle would be based on Dragon, its design would require some modifications and changes. Ken Bowersox is Associate Administrator for Space Operations at NASA's Mission Directorate in Washington, D.C. He said in a statement that having a deorbit vehicle will help NASA and its international partners ensure a safe and responsible transition in low Earth orbit at the end of station operations. Bowersox noted that although the current ISS cannot continue forever, it will remain a blueprint for science, exploration, and partnerships until its service ends in 2030. Once the ISS is retired, NASA plans to use privately developed space laboratories for its space research needs. The agency has already chosen several American companies to develop future space stations. NASA has said a deorbiting operation would begin by slowly lowering the ISS altitude level. Officials have said this will likely be carried out by the ISS and its systems without the need for additional spacecraft. But the final part of the operation is re-entry. This will require guiding the ISS into Earth's atmosphere to a target in an unpopulated area of the ocean. The targeted landing spot has been identified as a place called Point Nemo in the South Pacific Ocean. This is a stretch of open water between New Zealand and the southernmost part of South America. The U.S. National Ocean Service identifies Point Nemo as the point in the ocean that is farthest from land. NASA predicts that most ISS equipment will burn up or vaporize during the intense heat of atmospheric reentry. But it says some dense or heat-resistant elements are expected to survive and land in the ocean. I'm Brian Lynn.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And now, the lesson of the day.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
Today, we're going to look at Lesson 9 from Level 2 of the series. Anna and her friend Ashley talk about their pets, and they talk about things they could have or should have done.
Pets are animals that live with families, such as dogs or cats.
Ashley's pet is a dog named Dublin. But Anna's pet is, well, it's very unusual.
That's because Anna's pet is a rock.
It's true. Anna has a pet rock. Of course, this is a kind of joke. Anna makes her rock look like it has eyes and hair. And her rock wins a contest for one-of-a-kind pets. One-of-a-kind means unique, which means there are no others the same as it.
We spell unique, U-N-I-Q-U-E.
Now, let's listen to Anna tell Ashley how she won a contest with her pet rock.
And our lesson will focus on the phrases should have and could have. Listen for these phrases, and we will explain more after you listen.
But, Anna, tell me, how did you win a pet contest without a pet?
Okay, the closest thing I have is my pet rock. I know it's silly, but I've had it since I was a little girl. So, for a joke, I brought it to the fair. But then I was invited to enter the one-of-a-kind pet contest. And I won!
Anna, only you could have won a pet contest with a pet rock. I should have brought Dublin. He would have won a contest.
It's not very easy to win one of these. Does he have a costume?
They had a costume contest. You should have seen this little girl.
She and her dog wore matching princess costumes.
Dublin doesn't wear costumes.
Does he know any tricks?
Come this way. Now, watch this. One more.
You caught it, Dublin!
Yeah.
And you killed it! Oh, good dog! Ashley, he could have won the best catch contest.
Oh, good boy.
Ashley, pets are fun, aren't they?
Yes, and they become part of your family.
Did you hear the examples with should have, could have, or would have? We can say should to give advice, as in this example.
You should try to speak English.
And we say should have plus the past participle of the verb. When we talk about actions in the past, we wish had been different. Ashley said,
I should have brought Dublin. He would have won a contest.
Ashley didn't bring Dublin to the contest, but she wishes she had brought him.
When we talk about the past, but wish it had been different, or think about the past in a way that is different than what really happened, we say should have, or could have, or would have, before the past participle of the verb.
But native speakers usually shorten these with contractions, so it sounds like this. Should have, could have, would have.
And sometimes native speakers reduce or shorten the pronunciation even more. So it sounds like this. Shoulda, coulda, woulda.
Oh, I wish my past had been different. Shoulda, woulda, coulda. I should have gone. I would have won. I could have seen my friends.
When you hear someone say shoulda, woulda, coulda, it's often because the person is saying it's not good to look back with regrets.
I know, but sometimes I wish I could have done something different.
Well, we all probably wish we could have done something different in the past. But now let's talk a little bit about owning a pet. After playing with Ashley's dog, Anna thinks she wants to own one.
Ashley, I think I want a dog. No, I know I want a dog.
It's a big responsibility. You may want to spend time with a dog first.
Responsibility is a noun. The plural of this noun is responsibilities. And the word responsible is the adjective.
And responsibly is the adverb.
We often use the preposition for after the adjective responsible. Jill, what are some of the things you are responsible for at your home?
Well, I shop for the food, and I cook quite a lot, and I also feed the dog and take the dog for walks and give the dog baths. That's a lot of responsibility, isn't it?
Well, it sounds like you do have a lot of responsibilities or things you are responsible for. And as Ashley says, owning a pet can be a big responsibility.
When you own something, that means it is yours. It belongs to you.
The state of owning something is called ownership. Jill, you have a dog. What responsibilities come with pet ownership?
And I'd like to say that I think my dog thinks she owns me. Well, first there are the basics. You have to make sure your pet has enough food and water and stays healthy. Sometimes you need to take your pet to the veterinarian, which means an animal doctor. And you have to protect your pet from danger, such as other animals or getting hit by a car. And then, especially for pets like dogs and cats, you should be nice to them and try to make them happy by petting them and speaking to them in a nice voice.
I've heard you speaking in a very sweet way to your dog, Jill. And I noticed you used the verb pet. So that means we pet our pets.
That's right. To pet means to gently touch and move your hand over an animal's hair or fur. Most dogs love to be petted. But you have to be careful because not all pets like to be petted. There are some dogs and cats that don't like to be touched or that only want their owner to touch them.
We can say that those animals are very touchy. If someone or some animal is touchy, that means they are very sensitive and can become upset or angry very easily.
My dog was like that when we first got her. That's because she was a rescue, a dog who had other owners who didn't want her or could no longer keep her.
Yes, we talk about animals being rescued when someone new takes them into their home. It takes some time for the animals to adjust to the new home. So, don't touch a touchy pet. But please, pet the pets that want to be touched.
Isn't English fun? We hope our lesson of the day has been fun for you. And we invite you to write to us about any pets that your family and friends have. And do your pets like to be petted? I used to have a turtle. I don't think it really cared if I petted it.
Probably not. You can email us at learningenglish@voanews.com.
And remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. Thanks for listening. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.